It's wonderful to see you, interactive ECG session, as we join every year. Along with me is Dr. Hiren Kevadia and Dr. Vineet Sankla, co-electrophysiologist at SIMS. Hiren has just finished 1 year at SIMS. He's a young, dynamic, upcoming electrophysiologist. And we have been doing some wonderful cases together. I'll also like to invite, if any of the chairpersons, moderators are in the audience, Dr. Kirit Akhani, Dr. Shailesh Desai, Dr. Basmang Trivedi, Dr. Hemang Acharya, Dr. Dinkar Goswami, Dr. Nitesh Patel, Prakash Patel, Tapan Shah. Vineet, in case you see anybody walking in, just call them up on the dais. Along with me, across the world, are Dr. Rahul Doshi, Dr. Ramesh Gowda, Dr. Guy Hendricks, Dr. Kalyanam Shivkumar, and Dr. Molly Shah. You just heard Dr. Rahul Doshi's voice from Los Angeles. So we'll start our interactive ECG session for the next 45 minutes. We'll have to discuss some interesting cases. You all have these booklets, I'm sure. Okay. Let's start off with the first case. We have about 10 cases to discuss, about 45 minutes. So we'll be doing around 5 minutes each. We'll try to move quickly. 72-year-old lady, recurrent atrial fibrillation. She's been on multiple antiarrhythmic drugs for a long time. And she's had a CVA in the past. She's recovered from the CVA. She was on NOAC. She had GI bleeding on NOAC. So multiple episodes of AF, not being able to control well despite medications. This is the ECG scene. She's had AF in the past, but this ECG looks a little more regular, isn't it? This is narrow QRS or wide QRS? Narrow QRS tachycardia. There is some irregularity here, but more or less it seems to be a little regular. Some irregularity seen in the latter part of the ECG also. There are some ST changes and more or less regular, some part irregularity. So in this patient, we have treated with medications for a long time. We need to address the basic problem. As you know, the sinus node normal rhythm comes from here. It's very regular. But in patients with atrial fibrillation, there are multiple wavelets in the atria. Some of them, some of the patients will have foci in the pulmonary veins, and that is what we target in atrial fibrillation. When we put in catheters, what appear to be very regular rhythm may not be very regular intracardiac. There is some changes in the activation pattern. So you are often fooled by ECG. We think it's a regular tachycardia, but it could be just atrial fibrillation, or it could be intra-atrial reentrant tachycardias. There are circuits inside them. Elderly lady with dilated LA. LA was around 60 millimeters, I think. So the way we target it is, Dr. Hiren, what do we do nowadays? Over the past few years, actually, what we've been doing is this.
Yeah, so this lady is already on antiarrhythmic drugs and she is still having recurrent episodes of atrial arrhythmia on antiarrhythmic drugs. And out of that antiarrhythmic drugs, one drug should be class 3. So it should be either cordoron or whatever in structural abnormal, or it can be class 1C like flecainide or propranolol. So she is already on drugs. So in that case, it becomes a class 1 indication for atrial fibrillation when it is a paroxysmal atrial fibrillation. And if it is persistent atrial fibrillation, which is lasting more than a week, here it is a class 2A indication to go for AF fibrillation because she is having recurrent arrhythmia despite of taking drugs.
So, yeah. So the plan is for AF fibrillation. Now, like I said, most of these wavelets, the foci are on the pulmonary veins. So what we have to do is go transseptal. Here is one catheter in the coronary sinus going from the femoral vein into the AV node region. And there's a sheath which is going from IVC, RA across the interatrial septum by transseptal puncture. And my ablation catheter is going into the LA. The pulmonary veins arise here. On fluoroscopy, sometimes this procedure becomes rather tedious. So by default, we use 3D mapping in this. 3D mapping is three-dimensional mapping of the cardiac geometry of the cardiac chambers. This is the left atrium And just like in fluoroscopy, we have pulmonary veins, there are pulmonary veins here. And here we are doing all these red points are ablation. So you are isolating the pulmonary veins by ablating in the left atrium, outside the pulmonary vein. So it's antral, circumferential antral ablation. And so you isolate the pulmonary veins. Whatever is happening inside the pulmonary vein is not transmitted to the atrium. So the atrial fibrillation will get terminated by that. And that is precisely what happened in this patient. Patient had sinus rhythm restored after ablation. But that is not the end of the story. The problem is the patient has had CVA on anticoagulants and has had GI bleeding on anticoagulant. The LA is dilated. In the future, there is still possibility of getting another stroke. And generally, 90% of the time, patients with non-valvular AF will have thrombus in the left atrial appendage, as you know. And when that gets embolized from here, it can cause a stroke. So what we do nowadays is occlude the left atrial appendage. So there is a device which is put across the atrium into the left atrial appendage, and this is occluded. So no further blood ingresses into the atrial appendage. There is the clot cannot displace from here and go to the break. And this is the first time in the country that this procedure was done simultaneously with AF ablation. So we did AF ablation and then I'm deploying this left atrial appendage occluder device. After deploying it here, we do something called wiggle maneuver. I'm trying to see if the appendage occluder is stable or not. So I'm vigorously trying to pull and push to see if it gets displaced, and it does not. There are prongs which hold on to the atrial appendage and atrial musculature, and that will prevent it from getting dislodged. The procedure is done under transesophageal echo, and this was a fairly long procedure. I think it lasted 5.5 hours, but it was a very gratifying procedure in this elderly lady. We could do the atrial fibrillation ablation, restore sinus rhythm, and then occlude the atrial appendage. The patient will be on anticoagulants for the next 3 months or so, but in some patients, we don't even need to do that. She can straight go on double antiplatelet therapy for 3 to 6 months and then may require only aspirin or clopidogrel, and that's it. So here you see the LA appendage occluder, and on the X-ray chest, you can see this device here. There are two small spots here, which are these, and the LA appendage occluder is nicely sitting in the heart. Any comments, Dr. Vineet or Hiren, before we go on to the next case?
Yeah, so basically the indication of doing LA appendage closure, if we discuss, like, if any patient who is having contraindication for taking anticoagulation drugs with atrial fibrillation, or if patient is having recurrent stroke despite of being on anticoagulation. So in that cases, we go for LA appendage occlusion. And for the residents or if medicine students are there, you can see the location of device. Where will you expect your LA appendage on X-ray? Just to see the anatomical location on X-ray. It's much down. Location of LA appendage on X-ray.
So in rheumatic heart disease, mitral stenosis patients, you will see LA appendage. We always talk in X-ray, prominence of the left atrial appendage because of left atrial enlargement. So the device is sitting there. Good. So next case. This is a 30-year-old lady who had presented with recurrent palpitations over last couple of years. And the episodes used to occur almost every day. She had undergone a procedure in another center but continued to have these episodes. And this was an extended loop recorder strip. Yesterday I talked about how AF is diagnosed. It's either by a 12-lead ECG or you take a single rhythm strip with at least 30 seconds. So in this patient, this ELR showed this recording. Any comments on this? It's labeled as ventricular tachycardia in a young person with normal heart. Otherwise, the rhythm is like this. Any comments, Hiren or Vinny?
So we can see there are two ECG strips there. First, we'll look at the lower one because it's very narrow QRS one. We can see that there is no clear-cut P wave visible in front of QRS. So in absence of P wave is there. And second thing, we can see the variation in RR interval. So whenever the RR is varying and the P wave is not visible, it becomes atrial fibrillation. So the lower one suggests it's atrial fibrillation with fast ventricular rate. And then we can go on to the upper strip. So we can see the again, same thing, the narrow QRS does not have P wave in front of them and it's irregular RR interval. So it is again atrial fibrillation. And we can see many a times in atrial fibrillation with fast ventricular rate, we get a rate related aberrancy also. So it may be either a rate related aberrancy. I mean, it is atrial fibrillation with aberrant conduction. Second possibility is really ventricular arrhythmias. We can see that the RR is still varying during that wide QRS also. And there is a short, long, short sequence also. So we can see the first wide QRS is having very short RR interval. So that is somewhat like seven small squares. So it is 280 milliseconds. So it is coming much prematurely. And that may be the reason that he is getting rate-related aberrant conduction rather than ventricular arrhythmias.
Yeah, excellent. Generally, if it is non-sustained VT or something, we expect it to be regular, but there is a regularity here. And in atrial fibrillation, we get Ashman's phenomenon, as it was explained. Long, short RR intervals can give rise to aberrancy. Previous ablation at another center for atrial fibrillation. Now episodes occurring throughout the day. And in the EP lab, her rhythm was, the narrow QRS rhythm seemed to be very regular. Then there is some irregularity. And then this very fast rhythm again appearing. With this fast rhythm, you are always worried again whether it's ventricular tachycardia or not. But like Dr. Hiren just mentioned, here it is regular. And there are some long, short sequences. Here it becomes irregular. And then this wide QRS comes. So these patients, again, she did not have any other reason for the arrhythmia. It was all atrial fibrillation or type of arrhythmia, which I'll talk about. We need to target it in the same way. It is coming from the left atrium. We have to target it very more precisely. So we do it with special mapping catheters like Pentaray or Lasso in the pulmonary veins. This is again a double transeptal which is performed, IVC-ERA, this is an interatrial septum. One sheath carries the diagnostic catheter, the other one has this ablation catheter. We use new techniques called contact force sensing to target these. Now inside, the electrograms recorded in the left atrium with the Pentaray catheter were very regular activation inside the atrium. So we saw part of the ECG which was showing regular rhythm. So this was showing regular rhythm, and probably that was further degenerating into atrial fibrillation in this patient. So if we could target this regular rhythm, probably we would be able to prevent atrial fibrillation also in this patient. So this was a intra-atrial reentrant tachycardia that the patient had. Regular RR intervals, atrial electrograms. So in this patient, this is the left atrium, pulmonary veins, here left superior, left inferior pulmonary vein, right superior, right pulmonary inferior vein. We mapped the tachycardia. It was an intra-atrial reentrant tachycardia going through the mitral annulus and the left inferior pulmonary vein here. So we target this narrow channel and ablated it. So this is between the left atrial appendage and the left inferior pulmonary vein and the mitral annulus. If we are able, the circuit is going around like this. If we are able to cut off this circuit at this point, this channel will be able to terminate the arrhythmia. That is what was done. This is the left atrium, left ventricle here. The mitral annulus is here. The left inferior pulmonary vein is here, and we are ablating in this region. And during ablation, as you can see, this is fast rhythm, suddenly terminates, patient is in sinus rhythm after that. So patient is in this narrow QRS tachycardia, ablation is going on, the arrhythmia terminates here, after that the patient is in sinus rhythm. So the girl who was suffering almost every day, almost 20-25 episodes a day, and she was miserable with antiarrhythmic drugs, previous procedure did not help, or maybe it was producing this intra-atrial reentrant tachycardia, and after this the patient is completely asymptomatic. Dr. Hiren, any thought about why previous ablation could have given rise to this kind of arrhythmia?
Yeah, so previously this patient has same atrial fibrillation, and for that patient was taken for EP study, 3D mapping guided. There person has isolated the left-sided pulmonary vein. So he has made that encircling around the left superior and left inferior pulmonary vein. So what happens that after doing that PV isolation, the inferior part of that left inferior pulmonary vein and mitral annulus, so there is a isthmus between that. So there is some conduction delay across that isthmus because of the previous ablation. And wherever there is heterogeneity in conduction in any part of the heart, there is some conduction delay that leads to the formation of reentrant circle. So most likely because of the previous ablation, there is a conduction delay in mitral isthmus, and that become now substrate for getting perimitral annular reentrant circle. And that's how it was getting a mitral annular flutter.
Great. And this is precisely what Hiren was talking about. This is the corridor or channel where it happens. And you ablate it and the tachycardia terminates. Patient is doing well after that. These seem to be complicated cases, but complex arrhythmias is what we are dealing with all day. 20 years you've learned regular SVTs, regular VTs. Now we are moving on to more complicated rhythms. And you will all get used to this also. Okay, more usual case.
This Sir, is I a had a comment yeah. for the previous case.
Yes, yes.
So, we have seen that the main clinical arrhythmia was atrial fibrillation for her. But when we taken her in EP lab, we were getting flutter. So, it was flutter clean on EP table, and otherwise it was atrial fibrillation. So, many a times we have observed that patient comes to a clinician with a rhythm strip showing is atrial fibrillation, but the duration of palpitation is maybe 2-3 hours. So we have observed many a times that this type of the patient is having basically SVT, either it is AVNRT or it is AVRT by some bypass tech, and that starting arrhythmia in such cases will be SVT, and then after 1 hour or something that degenerates into atrial fibrillation, and by the time patient reached to the clinician, he will be in atrial fibrillation. So we do EP study for such cases and try to find out other arrhythmias which are actually provocating for the atrial fibrillation. And many a times we will not to have either AVNRT or some concealed bypass tech. There will not be any pre-excitation, no WPW, but there is concealed bypass tech that is inducing AVRT, and that was degenerating into atrial fibrillation. And after doing EP SRFA of these SVTs, they will not have atrial fibrillation also in future.
Excellent. So this is a third case, 81-year-old gentleman, old anterior wall MI, recent inferior wall MI. Patient had severe LV dysfunction, underwent bypass surgery about 3 or 4 days prior to this trip, 3 days I think. And then post-op, patient had a VT storm, multiple shocks were given, I think he received 20 shocks in a day. This was a monitor strip, as you can see, there's a sinus rhythm going on. And then there is a PVC, and then there is some irregular rhythm, and then very fast VT has started up. And patient was, this is just 22nd July, and patient was getting this episode very frequently. Now in these cases, we try to temporize it, try to suppress it with by giving antiarrhythmic drugs. If we give beta blockers are very important. We need to sedate, the patient may need to be intubated, put on ventilator, various ways of managing the VT storm. Injection Xylocard or amiodarone, but amiodarone often with bradycardia can be proarrhythmic by itself. So we often need to do dual chamber temporary pacing for these patients. Despite that, now we have mexiletine in our armamentarium. Mexiletine is a good drug for proarrhythmic patients with proarrhythmias that we have used fairly commonly. And despite that, if the patient continues to have these episodes, then there is no choice but to take the patient in the EP lab. Remember, severe LV dysfunction, recent MI, recent bypass surgery, and patient is in VT storm. So they have to be taken while the volcano is still brewing and ready to burst. And we take these patients in the EP lab. What we need to do is we have to find this focus from where the VT is arising. We can map it by either we can try to look for it either by looking, doing a Holter or a 12-lead ECG if possible, and try to see if there is a consistent target which gives rise to the VT. Any comments about this, Irene? There are two episodes of NSVT recorded here. The initiating EVC.
So if you see the first part of the, I mean, left half of the screen, the first two beats are sinus beat. And then third beat is coming, and that is inducing the arrhythmia. So if you see the morphology of first extra beat, wide QRS, it's a right bundle branch morphology with a deep S in V5, V6. And if you see the axis, it is superior because 2, 3 and AVF are negative. So RBBB in V1 suggests that it's coming from left ventricle, and superior axis suggests that it might be coming from left posterior fascicle. So many a times this post MI patient or post CABG patient get automaticity from the vesicles and Purkinje fibers, and that's inducing the PVCs. And that PVCs, if it is very short coupled, falling R on T, will induce the polymorphic VT and VF.
Yeah, and remember, this patient had a previous anterior and now inferior wall infarct. There may be extensive scar, and the arrhythmias could be arising from the Purkinje system, where the ischemia induced insult can cause this, or re-entrant arrhythmia inside the scar can cause this. Now again, these patients we have to take in the EP lab. This catheter is in the AV node region, and since it's a, we have to go via the femoral artery, aorta, cross arch of aorta, through the aortic valve into the LV. Here we have the septal region where the Purkinje fibers lie. This is more the inferior wall from where the infarct was. What we see if there is scarring is fractionated signals, delayed signals. We have to target those. And this is more helped by doing 3D mapping, CARTO, electroanatomic mapping, or impedance-based mapping. What we need to do here is find the critical isthmus from where these arrhythmias are coming from. We have to ablate that, get rid of that channel. We have to ablate around the border zone of the scar, so we don't allow any of the problems inside the arrhythmias arising from inside the scar to affect later part of the rest of the ventricle. So we ablate those scars, and ablation with scar homogenization, any kind of islands of living surviving tissue which can give rise to arrhythmia, we ablate that. The PVCs which generally give rise to these arrhythmias are coming from the Purkinje system, from the left bundle branch region, and that lies around here. So we target that and ablate that also. During arrhythmia, occasionally there is increased automaticity. So it will mimic the natural, the VT rhythm. And this was showing a lot of noise, but it was the same pattern, RVBB superior axis. And once you ablate, after that, the ECG has become very quiet. Patient is in stable sinus rhythm. It's been, the patients are generally kept on beta blockers, maybe a small dose of amiodarone or mexiletine for a few months, and then generally remain on beta blockers and other optimal medications for their LV dysfunction, etc. It's been more than 9 months. Patient is doing quite well. So these are complicated arrhythmias that we are tackling. When you are saying 100, you are doing a great favor to the patient. Generally, they are in the 70s. And when we take them in the lab, they are in 70s all most of the time. So some of these patients we need to support with inotrope agents are going on. Some of them may be on IABP. These are very complicated problems. We have to manage the hemodynamics. Sometimes the patient is getting VT inside the lab. We are shocking them inside the lab and ablating. It has to be done quickly. It is firing which is done precisely and quickly. We need to manage the hemodynamics of the patient. We don't want to land up with more problems. These patients could be in cardiogenic shock also. Hiren, any points? Yes,
so the refractory ventricular arrhythmias, severe LV dysfunction with hypotension. So they are almost very critical patients. So very critical patient, they will be on ventilator, double inotropes, on inotropic supports. We go for we give either noradrenaline or dobutamine most of the time. And if at all refractory, then only we go for adrenaline. So we go for triple inotrope also if required during ablation, especially because we want some hemodynamic stability during the procedure so that we have enough time to give enough ablations on the required areas.
Okay. Yeah, so we titrate the beta blockers, start with a very, very small dose and try to step it up. But beta blockers are very important and protective in these patients.
Sometimes they might be getting significant bradycardia also. Maybe hypotension may be there. Sometimes hypotension may not be there, but bradycardia is there. And bradycardia with VT storm. So in that case, we go for dual chamber temporary pacemaker, pace the atria at a faster rate around 80 to 100, and then give beta blocker so that bradycardia will be avoided and we can give drugs also together.
Okay, let's go on to the next case. 74-year-old gentleman, episodes of presyncope and syncope. EF was 25%. The patient had undergone angiogram in the past that was showing normal coronaries. This is the ECG which is recorded. As you can see, there is one sinus beat, three PVCs or white complex beats, another sinus beat. There is a PVC coming in, multiple episodes of runs of PVCs. But the PVC morphology seems to be same. It is minor variation, but otherwise the vector of the QRS complex seems to be the same. Even the morphology is more or less similar to the previous case. There is RBBB pattern, predominant RN V1, and there is superior axis, negative in 2-3 AVF. It's negative in 1 and positive in AVL. So it's right bundle branch pattern, that means it's coming from LV. Superior axis, again, probably coming from the inferior wall region. What is different about these PVCs is the PVCs are very wide. They are not your they are extremely wide. So these could be coming from the epicardial aspect, or it could be coming from the papillary muscles of the heart. When they are coming from the Purkinje system or near the septum, they are generally much thinner, less wide QRS of PVCs generally seen. Like in the previous case, it was coming from the Purkinje region, the QRS was less wide, but here these are very wide. So patient with normal coronary angio LV dysfunction and having these multiple episodes. Why was he having syncope? Because probably he was getting episodes like this. This is the only clinical ECG I had during the problem. You see very wide QRS, V4, up to V4 it is positive. We don't have V1, V2, V3 in that ECG. It was negative in V5, V6 and negative in lead 1, negative in 2, 3 AVF. So RBBB pattern coming from the LV, negative in 1 and negative in inferior leads. So probably it's going towards Pakistan, northwest axis. And it's coming from somewhere from the LV inferior region or papillary muscle region. So here also we target like this. We know it is coming from the LV. We take the catheter down into the left ventricle region. And if you see where my catheter is now, if the first activation is here, it will point towards Pakistan, towards northwest axis. It will correspond to what rhythm the patient, the axis of the VT that the patient had. This is what we saw inside the lab. This is sinus beat and this is the PVC. What we are looking for with my ablation catheter is early activation, whether we can get early point from where these PVCs could be arising. It's like a pond where you put in a stone and then ripples come out of it. So you have to find the water ripples where it first started. So these electrical signals also we find where is the first point from where it has started. And again, 3D mapping helps a lot here in this patient. This is the left ventricle which is mapped, and the early point in the left ventricle was in this inferior posterior lateral region where the papillary muscle is. It's often difficult to ablate because these are big, thick muscles. So we often use extensive energy. We get use irrigated energy to ablate it. And it is an extensive procedure. We have to really give deep energies to get rid of the problem. But fortunately for this patient, we could get rid of it. All the PVCs disappeared. Patient was in stable sinusism after that. This procedure was done about 4 months ago. And in 2 months, the EF improved to 45%. And patient is doing very well. Is only on a small dose of beta blockers now and doing very well. Any comments about this, Dr. Vineet or Dr. Hiren?
Yeah, so this patient had, we know LVEF was just 25% before ablation, and that has become 45%. What does it suggest? It suggests that this ejection fraction, which was lower side, was because of actually this frequent ventricular arrhythmias. So that is known as tachycardia induced cardiomyopathy. It may be either frequent PVCs, like more than 25% burden PVCs. It may be frequent NSVT, sometimes frequent runs of atrial arrhythmias. So this patient will go into finally LV dysfunction, heart failure, and that is all because of that tachycardia. And once we remove that tachycardia part, all that LV dysfunction, which was because of that, will get recovered. Patient will not have heart failure also. So basically, by treating this arrhythmia, he's getting rid of arrhythmia component also and heart failure component also by recovering the LV ejection fraction.
So tachycardiomyopathy, we see not only with atrial fibrillation, with the persistent SVTs, with atrial flutter, with some kind of idiopathic LV tachycardias, but also frequent PVCs. And Hiren has ablated a number of patients in the past 6 months with frequent PVC-induced tachycardiomyopathy. And it's so gratifying that the patient's PVCs disappear, symptoms disappear, and the LV function improves after that. So that is really gratifying in this patient. Coming to the next case, this is a complex problem. 70-year-old gentleman, complete heart block. Dr. Milan Bhai had implanted a pacemaker in 1997. And now it's 2021. So it's like 24 years of care being given for this patient. And a patient developed LV dysfunction, heart failure, and upgraded to CRT pacemaker in 2003. Then because of end of battery life, replaced it in 2010. Patient was getting VT. So when the time came for replacement in 2017, I had replaced it with a CRT defibrillator. And patient now came in February, just last month, with multiple shocks due to the from the device. This is his X-ray picture. Can you identify? It's like multiple arrows coming out of a bow. Vineet, can you identify the number of leads here? This is in the atrial appendage. This is a pacemaker lead which was probably put in 97, thin lead, unipolar lead. This was my pacemaker lead during the CRTP, either during 2003 or 2010. I might have had to replace probably in 2003. And this is a CRT defibrillator lead which I put in 2017. And this thin lead is the LV lead for CRTP. In 2003, these were the only leads available, unipolar LV lead. And the patient surviving still because of that. This is the ECG which was recorded. Actually, this was not an ECG. During shocks, only we can interrogate the device and get the arrhythmia. So I had put in a holter while the patient was in the ICU to find the morphology of tachycardia that the patient was having. So here it is paced rhythm, as you can see. There are pacing spike, atrial pacing, and biventricular pacing going on here. And then the patient starts getting this non-sustained VT. And can you see the morphology? Can you comment on the morphology in V1? Again, it's RBBB pattern. So it's coming from the LV. And again, it's negative in 2, 3 and AVF. So again, RBBB pattern coming from the LV. Superior rastus coming from the inferior wall region. Now, these are the issues that this patient had. diabetic, obstructive sleep apnea, obese patients, short stage hypothyroidism, deep venous thrombosis in the past, he's on anticoagulation, and RCA disease. These are the multiple leads which I just showed. This is the CRTD device that he had. And the same use. You can see the LV lead at this point. In the lab, we could induce this arrhythmia very easily. It is corresponding to his clinical arrhythmia, RBBP pattern, and superior axis, coming from more or less the same region. Remember, this patient has sort of a cardiomyopathy, and the signals are all very small amplitude, scarred region. The electrograms are of very low quality. Here we targeted it in the inferior wall region, and this was a peculiar arrhythmia coming from the inferoposterior aspect of the left ventricle. These are two islands of scars, and probably the VT was going around as a re-entry in this region between the scar and the mitral annulus, just like we had that intra-atrial re-entrant tachycardia, which was giving rise to a supraventricular arrhythmia in that first, in the young girl. Here it was a VT which is coming between the mitral annulus and ventricular scar, in the corridor between the mitral annulus and the scar, and that was producing this VT. And that was ablated, and patient remained in stable rhythm after that. The patient has underlying atrial fibrillation also. So AV node has been suppressed, so patient has consistent biventricular pacing, and patient is on anticoagulation, NOACs for this. Any comment on the need to suppress AV node while doing BIV pacing for the audience? Hiren or Vineet, produce.
So basically, we require a biventricular pacing. So if the if there's a very fast, we can do a AV nodal ablation also. So we have to require a biventricular pacing with LV pacing and RV pacing in this case. So pacing is required. Otherwise, there will not be a coordinated contraction of LV and RV.
Correct. So the actually the patient had complete heart block, and pacemaker was implanted for that indication in 97. And after that, the patient was in sinus rhythm for a few years. Then paroxysmal AF, and progressively he went into persistent and then permanent AF. But because there was CHV, it was not affecting the ventricular activation, and the patient has BIV pacing, so consistent BIV pacing could be achieved with this. Coming to the flip side, coming to the Brady side, we talked about a lot about tachyarrhythmia. This is a 61-year-old gentleman, pre-syncope and fatigue. There are two P waves and one QRS. It's very simple.
What does ECG?
2:1 AV block, isn't it? Okay, 2:1 AV block. What is interesting about the QRS complex? Anything? It's a narrow QRS rhythm, isn't it? Narrow QRS. So 2:1 AV block with narrow QRS, it is conducting down the AV node when it does with a narrow QRS. What about the PP interval?
PP interval, yeah.
Here it is a little short, here it is a little long, here it is a little short and a little long. So the PP interval on either side of the QRS is a little shorter than the PP interval without the QRS. What is it called? It's ventriculophasic sinus arrhythmia. We often see this in patients with AV block like this. It is due to a variation in the rate of the sinus because of the contraction will affect the carotid sinus receptor, and the atrial rhythm rate will change. So the PP interval, which are encompassing the QRS, are a little shorter than those without. So very interesting problem. Now, this patient is an elderly person with pre-syncope, fatigue, 2:1 AV block, narrow QRS. If we give this patient a routine pacemaker, the patient will end up with a wide QRS rhythm. So what are the options that can be given to give the best possible hemodynamics to this patient? What can we do? There are something new which is being done over the past couple of years now. So what we do is, we are actually doing conduction system pacing, where either instead of putting the pacemaker lead into the ventricle, we either put it in the bundle of his, or we go through the IV septum and pierce the IV septum with the ventricular lead and stimulate the left bundle branch. And then we are giving the electrical signals to the conduction system, and we try to get a narrow QRS in these patients. If with a narrow QRS, the patient gets a wide QRS with regular pacing, you are actually doing a sort of disservice. So the target is try to put the lead in the bundle of his, the AV node bundle of his region, the right bundle, the left bundle. And we try to either screw in the lead here. It has to be very precise. So we do it with the help of EP system, look at the electrical signals, or try to pierce the IVS and go into the left bundle. And this is done with special leads or special sheets. We try to mimic the natural activation of the ventricle here. So this is a lead in the his, and this is the lead in the left bundle branch. The IV septum is thick like this, and the lead has gone through the IV septum. This is a MRI done after that, and that is showing the lead inside the IV septum. This is a narrow QRS. With regular pacing, it would give rise to wide QRS. But with this kind of pacing, the patient has a narrow QRS. This is the same patient. This is a special lead. It's much thinner than the regular lead. And then a dual chamber pacemaker is implanted. And we are landing up with now 1:1 AV conduction. This is sinus rhythm, A sense, V pacing. But the QRS is very narrow due to left bundle branch pacing, due to conduction system pacing in this patient. So this is something new which we've been doing for the last couple of years. And that is chosen for certain patients who you would have such problems. Comments about this, Dr. Hiren or Dr. Vineet, or anything from the audience? We'll talk about this a little bit in the next talk also. We have about 5 minutes remaining.
Yeah, so we have 5 minutes only. I think we have three more messages.
Okay, we talked about devices, and this becomes important in some patients. 67-year-old gentleman, heart block, pacemaker done 3 years ago at another place. I'm showing you some structure. The problem here is the patient had an infection, and we need to remove. Infections in pacemaker or devices cannot be treated by antibiotics alone. If there is a discharge, you have to take the entire system out. Otherwise, it is not going to work. You do plastic surgery, you give IV antibiotics for 4-6 weeks, nothing is going to work. Temporarily, it may get things under control, but after 2 months, 6 months, everything is going to start problems again. So here we have to extract the entire system. Open it, remove the device, that's easy enough. But removing the leads can be a problem. Over years, they get fibrosed, and trying to remove them can be a problem. So in this case, this ventricular lead has been removed easily, but atrial lead is very difficult to remove. It is adherent to the SVCRA region. Here we use special things called locking stylets that is introduced inside the lead, and with steady traction and with praying to God at that time, have removed this. Now this patient is complete heart block, and we have to treat him with IV antibiotics for at least 7 to 10 days. In that case, we cannot keep him on a temporary pacemaker in the ICU for a long time. The patient becomes immobilized. So what is done here is a routine permanent pacing lead is put through the internal jugular vein and screwed into the septum. And this is an old device which is exteriorized. The lead is exteriorized, and it is connected to a permanent routine pacemaker outside. And the patient was discharged after 1 or 2 days, continued on IV antibiotics. This area was settled down, and then the patient was readmitted, and a new system was put from the right side. Now, if a patient has had an infection, the chances of reinfection are very high. Routinely, the infection rate is less than 1% in good centers and good hands. But reinfection rate could be anything between 2 to 5%. So this is a new thing which is put in. This is a Tyrex envelope. It's an antibacterial envelope. It's a polymer which elutes rifampin and minocycline over the next 7 days. And the chances of infection are reduced by more than 50%. It's a little expensive. It's almost a lakh. But in patients with getting high-end devices, comorbidities, diabetics, who are likely to have problems, this becomes an important point, important thing which will prevent further infection in these patients. So this is called Tyrex envelope, which we are using nowadays in some patients, and it becomes very important. 80-year-old lady, complete heart block, pacemaker done 3 years ago, syncope. Now, this is the picture you have in your booklet, but what the patient had is a pacemaker which was very close, implanted very close to the shoulder joint. And every time the patient moved her shoulder joint or moved her arm across, she would get syncope. There was a lead fracture in this lead. And again, here we need to remove these leads and try to either implant a new system from the left side or a new system from the same side. And can you see this? I'm trying to pull this lead out. Nothing is coming out. It's severely fibrosed in this region. So lead fracture at shoulder joint or costoclavicular region, because slightly higher placement of the pacemaker, severely adherent leads to the SVC-RA junction. Again, here we have to use these special stylets to try to remove it. There are certain sheets or laser sheets which we can use. There are implements like this tight rail or shorty, which we can put over the lead and try to isolate. So with the lead locking stylet, I could remove one lead. The other lead, whatever I did, could not come out. And if we become too aggressive, there are chances of rupture of the SVC-RA junction and patient may have to go for emergency surgery. So we isolated that. That was at a very high region and completely isolated that pocket from this new pocket. New system was put in and we used the same device. It was re-implanted in the same region. This was barely done about two, 3 weeks ago. Patient came for follow-up yesterday and she's doing very well. She's asymptomatic completely. So lead extraction is something which is we have to do now and then. It's an adrenaline releasing procedure. But we have to do especially infected cases. Okay, last two cases, we'll try to go through them quickly. We have about 10 minutes. 72-year-old lady, left modified radical mastectomy in the past, severe triple vessel disease, LV function was 35%, CABG was done 3 days ago. This was just a month back. This is the rhythm which is recorded in the after the CABG. What we see here is a wide complex rhythm, wide complex tachycardia. It appears to be regular, but there are periods of irregularity also here. Some RR intervals are short, some are a little wider. So what is it likely to be? Irregular RR interval? Irregularly irregular RR intervals, likely to be atrial fibrillation. The patient was in atrial fibrillation with fast ventricular rates. Rates were between 130 to 150 beats per minute. And that was again affecting the hemodynamics for this patient. She was tried with multiple antiarrhythmic drugs. She was on IV Cordron, beta blockers. She was getting cardioversions almost twice a day. We were trying. She would go back to sinusism for two or three beats and then get ERAF, early recurrence of atrial fibrillation. And again, she would be in atrial fibrillation with fast ventricular rate. The wide QRS was due to LBBBB, left bundle branch block pattern that this patient had. What is the next option in this case? What can we do? We have tried antiarrhythmic drugs. The patient has LV dysfunction. We have tried cardioversion. So the next thing is we have to be aggressive. We have to ablate the AV node in this patient. But if we ablate the AV node, the patient will land up with zero heart rate. Ventricular rate will be very less. She'll be, if there is an escape rhythm. So we need to implant a pacemaker. Now patient has LV dysfunction. If we implant a routine pacemaker with a lead in the RV, then that would further worsen the LV dysfunction. So then we have to plan for a CRT for this patient. One lead in the LV and one lead in the RV. So during bypass surgery, actually this is a scenario that I had visualized that this is likely to happen in this patient that will land up with trouble. So I had told the surgeons beforehand only, when we put in a CRT, the difficult job is to get a good LV lead position with good parameters. So I told the surgeons, do one thing when you're doing bypass surgery, just put an epicardial LV lead and tunnel it to the area where the pacemaker would otherwise be placed. And that is what they had done. So I took the patient in the cath lab, and this is the LV epicardial lead which the surgeons had implanted. Remember, it is in the LV lateral wall. The patient had a left modified radical mastectomy. There was not much tissue here, so it had to be tunneled across the sternum to the right side, and it was kept here in the subcutaneous region. And then I went in and ablated the AV node. These are temporary pacing wires for backup. And during ablation, then the ventricular rate, which was very fast, it becomes regular. Atrial fibrillation patient with regular RR intervals means the patient has a complete heart block. So I could achieve the AV node ablation here. And luckily in this patient, it was a stable escape rhythm. Rate was between 50 and 60 beats per minute. But you cannot leave it at that. So next thing is this LV lead, which was put in this region in the right infraclavicular region, I could exteriorize from the pocket and then implanted the two other leads. RA lead and a defibrillator lead, and the patient now has a CRTD implant. So complicated problem, LV dysfunction, atrial fibrillation, fast ventricular rate. By visualizing what could happen, with the foresight, we could put the LV epicardial lead in. And post procedure, post bypass surgery, the patient had AV node ablation and a very stable sinus rhythm, atrial fibrillation, bi-V pacing with a narrow looking QRS here. And even when the patient went into atrial fibrillation, now because the AV node is ablated, she's not getting fast ventricular rate. And the patient has narrow QRS due to bi-V pacing and stable hemodynamics. So finally, coming to the last case, this is COVID era case. 83-year-old gentleman, old anterior wall MI, LV function 25%. Patient had undergone angioplasty in the past, but then had an occluded stent or occluded LAD. Rest of the coronaries were fine. The patient had ventricular tachycardia in 2019, and ICD I had implanted at that time, a dual chamber ICD was put in. That was in December 2020. For 1 year, the patient was fine, did not have any problems, doing very well. And patient had VT storm in December 2020. Overnight, suddenly patient had multiple shocks. When we checked, the patient was COVID positive. And this is our experience over the past year. Patients who have been absolutely stable, suddenly coming with ventricular tachycardia storm, ICDs delivering shocks, or patients getting episodes of atrial fibrillation. Some patients are having episodes of tachybrady syndrome. So COVID produces a lot of arrhythmias. Patient was stabilized, in fact, with IV Maxil, IV Amiodarone, beta blockers, now Mexiletine. Remdesivir was given, steroids were given. This is an 83-year-old gentleman. And we could temporize, we could get things under control for a few days. For those 2 weeks, still we waited the patient to become non-infective. Even during that time, the patient had occasional episodes. But fortunately, with antiarrhythmic drug and managing the ICD, we were able to reduce shocks as much as possible, and with anti-tachy pacing, we could control it. And post-infective phase, 2 weeks after the COVID period was over, we took him in the lab. He had anterior wall MIs. You can get an idea of how dilated this LV is. We mapped this scar. It was a huge scar. This red area in the 3D mapping is scarred region. The purple area is healthy region. So the inferior posterior lateral wall are more healthy, but the entire anterior region, the apical region, the apico inferior region is completely scarred. And like I explained, we look at the isthmus ablated, we look at the border zones, we ablate those, And inside the scar, whatever is the living tissue, we have to target that and ablate, so that the patient, not only do we take care of the ventricular arrhythmias which are arising at that point of time, but the potential channels and potential foci from where the patient could get future ventricular arrhythmias are also ablated and got rid of at this time. So this is a month after the procedure. The patient was doing well. No further arrhythmias, no ICD therapies. He resumed his routine lifestyle and activities of daily living. So this 83-year-old gentleman with LV dysfunction, CAD, COVID, went through all this and came out, and he's doing very well. So let's wind up here. Any questions from the audience? Any comments? Otherwise, we can move on to the next. Vineet?
Yeah, I think the last case was fantastic because this gentleman was 83 years old. Just imagine how the life has advanced in 83, and now he's back to his normal routine activity.
He's a senior orthopedic surgeon's father.
Okay. So previously, like before 20-25 years, anybody at 83 years of age, we would have not thought of this kind of procedure. Okay, 83 is fine, it's okay. But now we can see. So very fantastic and very informative ECG sessions. In fact, ECG is always very fun to learn. And Dr. Ajay is there with us, Dr. Hiren. And as usual, this is the best sessions of all the GA.